There has been nobody tougher on Russia than Donald Trump.
I have not taken a penny from any foreign source ever in my life. We learned that this president paid 50 times the tax in China, has a secret bank account with China, does business in China, and in fact is talking about me taking money. I have not taken a single penny from any country whatsoever, ever. Number one. Number two, this is a president. I have released all of my tax returns. 22 years. Go look at them. 22 years of my tax return. You have not released a single solitary year of your tax return. What are you hiding? Why are you unwilling? The foreign countries are paying you a lot. Russia's paying you a lot. China's paying you a lot. And your hotels and all your businesses all around the country, all around the world. And China's building a new road to a new golf course you have overseas. So what's going on here? Why don't release your tax return or stop talking about corruption?
President Trump, your response.
First of all, I called my accountants, underwrote it. I'm going to release them as soon as we can. I want to do it. And it'll show how successful, how great this company is. But
you just said you spoke to your accountant about potentially releasing your taxes. Did he tell you when you can release them? Do you have a deadline for when you're going to release them?
I get treated worse than the Tea Party got treated. Because I have a lot of people in there, deep down in the IRS, they treat me horribly. We made a deal, it was all settled until I decide to run for president. I get treated very badly by the IRS, very unfairly. But we had a deal all done. As soon as we're completed with the deal, I want to release it. But
respond very quickly, and then I'll get to my question.
Why did he's been saying this for 4 years? Show us. Just show us. Stop playing around. You've been saying for 4 years you're going to release your taxes. Nobody knows, Mr. President. What they do know is you're not paying your taxes, or you're paying taxes that are so low. When last time he said what he paid, he said, I only pay that little because I'm smart. I know how to game the system. Come on. Come on, folks.
So please.
Our response is, look, this isn't about, there's a reason why he's bringing up all this malarkey. There's a reason for it. He doesn't want to talk about the substantive issues. It's not about his family and my family. It's about your family. And your family's hurting badly. If you're making less than, if you're a middle-class family, you're getting hurt badly right now. You're sitting at the kitchen table this morning deciding, well, we can't get new tires, they're bald, because we have to wait another month or so. Or are we going to be able to pay the mortgage? Or who's going to tell her she can't go back to community college? They're the decisions you're making in the middle-class families like I grew up in Scranton and Claymont. They're in trouble. We should be talking about your families, but that's the last thing he wants to talk about. And so if you want to do something about it and help, if not, it's going to continue. He's done. He's legitimized North Korea. He's talked about his good buddy, who's a thug, a thug.
We have a good relationship. You know, people don't understand. Having a good relationship with leaders of other countries is a good thing.
We have a lot of questions to get to. Your response.
Like saying we had a good relationship with Hitler before he, in fact, invaded Europe, the rest of Europe. Come on.
All right.
Somebody should ask the question.
You can ask.
He goes for a year. There will be
We have a number of topics.
No, but that's a big question.
We're going to get to.
It's the same thing with socialized medicine.
I have to respond.
Vice President, your response, please.
My response is: people deserve to have affordable health care. Period. Period, period, period. And the Biden care proposal will, in fact, provide for that affordable health care, lower premiums. What we're going to do is going to cost some money.
Then I want to talk about
what's happening
on Capitol Hill. When he says public
option, he's talking about socialized medicine and health care. When he talks about a public option, he's talking about destroying your Medicare, totally destroyed, and destroying your Social Security. And this whole country will come down. You know, Bernie Sanders tried it. In his state. He tried it in his state. His governor was a very liberal governor. They want to make it work.
Okay. Let's hear Vice President Biden's response.
He thinks he's running against somebody else. He's running against Joe Biden. I beat all those other people because I disagreed with them. Joe Biden he's running against. And the idea that we're in a situation that they're going to destroy Medicare, this is the guy that the actuary at Medicare said, if in fact, at Social Security, if in fact he continues to withhold his plan to withhold the tax on Social Security will be bankrupt by 2023 with no way to make up for it. This is the guy who's tried to cut Medicare. So I mean, the idea that Donald Trump is lecturing me on Social Security and Medicare? Come on.
He said the stock market will boom if I'm elected. If he's elected, the stock market will crash.
Okay, let's move on to the next question. Very quickly.
Look, the idea that the stock market is booming is his only measure of what's happening. Where I come from in Scranton and Claymont, the people don't live off of the stock market.
They understand.
As of tonight, more than 12 million people are out of work. And as of tonight, 8 million more Americans have fallen into poverty and more families are going hungry every day. Those hit hardest are women and people of color. They see Washington fighting over a relief bill. Mr. President, why haven't you been able to get them the help they need? 30 seconds here.
Because Nancy Pelosi doesn't want to approve it. I do.
But you're the president.
I do, but I still have to get. Unfortunately, that's one of the reasons I think we're going to take over the House because of her. Nancy Pelosi doesn't want to approve anything because she'd love to have some victories on a date called November 3rd. Nancy Pelosi does not want to approve it. We are ready, willing, and able to do something. Don't forget, we've already approved three plans, and it's gone through, including the Democrats, in all fairness. This one she doesn't want. It's near the election because she thinks it helps her politically. I think it hurts her politically.
All right, Mr. Vice President,
you know, the Republican leader in the United States Senate said he can't pass it. He will not be able to pass it. He does not have Republican votes. Why isn't he talking to his Republican friends?
Let me follow up with you, Vice President.
If we made a deal, Biden, because
let me ask Vice President Biden a question. You are the leader of the Democratic Party. Why have you not pushed the Democrats to get a deal for the American people?
Well, I have, and they have pushed it. Look, they passed this act all the way back in the beginning of the summer. This is like it's not new. It's been out there. This HEROES Act has been sitting there. And look at what's happening. When I was in charge of the Recovery Act with $800 billion, I was able to get $145 billion to local communities that have to balance their budgets and states that have to balance their budgets, so then have to fire firefighters, teachers, first responders, law enforcement officers, so they can keep their cities and counties running. He will not support that. They have not done a thing for them. And Mitch McConnell said, let them go bankrupt. Let him go bankrupt. Come on. What's the matter with
these
guys?
The bill that was passed in the House was a bailout of badly run, high crime, Democrat, all run by Democrats, cities and states. It was a way of getting a lot of money, billions and billions of dollars to these states. It was also a way of getting a lot of money from our people's pockets to people that come into our country illegally. We were going to take care of everything for them. And what that does, and I'd love to do that, I'd love to help them, but what that does, everybody all over the world will start pouring into our country. We can't do it. This was a way of taking care of them. But it was really a big bailout for badly run Democrat cities and states.
All right,
if I get elected, I'm running as a proud Democrat, but I'm going to be an American president. I don't see red states and blue states. What I see is American, United States. And folks, every single state out there finds themselves in trouble. They're going to start laying off, whether they're red or blue, cops, firefighters, first responders, because teachers, because they have to balance their budget. And the founders were smart. They allowed the federal government to deficit spend to compensate for the United States of America.
I want to talk about the federal minimum wage to $15 an hour. You said recently you would consider raising the federal minimum wage to $15 an hour. Is that still the case?
And I would consider it to an extent, but
in a
what I really like, what I
in
a second administration, but not to a level that's going to put all these businesses out of business. It should be a state option. Look, I've lived in different places. I know different places. They're all different. Some places, $15 is not so bad. In other places, other states, $15
would
be
ruinous. President Trump, thank you. Quick response, Vice President Biden.
Two jobs, one job, be below poverty. People are making $6, $7, $8 an hour. These first responders, we all clap for as they come down the street because they've allowed us to make it. What's happening? They deserve a minimum wage of $15. Anything below that puts you below the poverty level. And there is no evidence that when you raise the minimum wage, businesses go out of business. That is simply not true.
We're going to talk about immigration. We're going to talk about immigration now, gentlemen. And we're going to talk about families within this context. Mr. President, your administration separated children from their parents at the border, at least 4,000 kids. You've since reversed your zero tolerance policy, but the United States can't locate the parents of more than 500 children. So how will these families ever be reunited?
Children are brought here by coyotes and lots of bad people, cartels, and they're brought here, and they used to use them to get into our country. We now have as strong a border as we've ever had. We're over 400 miles of brand new wall. You see the numbers, and we let people in, but they have to come in legally, and they come in through
America. But how will you reunite these kids with their families, Mr. President?
They built cages. You know, they used to say, I built the cages. And then they had a picture in a certain newspaper, and it was a picture of these horrible cages, and they said, look at these cages. President Trump built them. And then it was determined they were built in 2014. That was him.
Do you have a plan to reunite the kids?
Yes, we're working on it we're trying very hard. But a lot of these kids come out without the parents. They come over through cartels and through coyotes and through gangs.
Vice President Biden, let me bring you into this conversation. Quick response, and then another question to you.
These 500-plus kids came with parents. They separated them at the border to make it a disincentive to come to begin with. Bay, real tough. We're really strong. And guess what? They cannot. It's not coyotes didn't bring them over. Their parents were with them. They got separated from their parents. Violates every notion of who we are as a nation. And this is the first president in the history of the United States of America that anybody seeking asylum has to do it in another country. That's never happened before in America. That's never happened before in America. You come to the United States and you make your case that I seek asylum based on the following premise, why I deserve it under American law. They're sitting in squalor on the other side of the river.
President Trump, your response,
so
30
important.
Seconds, and then we'll move
it
on.
It just shows that he has no understanding of immigration or the laws.
Vice President Biden, your response.
Know the law, what he's telling you is simply not true.
Well, check it out. They don't come back.
Check it out.
All right, let's move on.
But we don't have to worry about it because they terminated it. So we don't have to worry about it.
Let's move on to the next section.
And you have 525 kids not knowing where in God's name they're going to be and lost their parents.
Go ahead.
All right. Let's talk about our next section, which is race in America. And I want to talk about the way black and brown Americans experience race in this country. Part of that experience is something called the talk. It happens regardless of class and income. Parents who feel they have no choice but to prepare their children for the chance that they could be targeted, including by the police, for no reason other than the color of their skin. Mr. Vice President, in the next 2 minutes, I want you to speak directly to these families. Do you understand why these parents fear for their children?
I do. You know, my daughter is a social worker, and she's written a lot about this. She's has a graduate degree from the University of Pennsylvania in social work. And, you know, one of the reasons why I ended up working on the east side of Wilmington, Delaware, which is 90% African-American, was to learn more about what was going on. I never had to tell my daughter, if she's pulled over, make sure she puts for a traffic stop, put both hands on top of the wheel and don't reach for the glove box because someone may shoot you. But a black parent, no matter how wealthy or how poor they are, has to teach their child when you're walking down the street, don't have a hoodie on when you go across the street, making sure that you, in fact, if you get pulled over, yes, sir, no, sir, hands on top of the wheel, because you are, in fact, the victim, whether you're a person making $300,000 a year person or someone who's on food stamps. The fact of the matter is there is institutional racism in America. And we have always said, we've never lived up to it, that we hold these truths to be self-evident. All men and women are created equal. But guess what? We have never, ever lived up to it, but we've always constantly been moving the needle further and further to inclusion, not exclusion. This is the first president to come along and says, that's the end of that. We're not going to do that anymore. We have to provide for economic opportunity, better education, better health care, better access to schooling, better access to opportunity to borrow money to start businesses. All the things we can do, and I've laid out a clear plan as to how to do those things. Just to give people a shot. It's about accumulating the ability to have wealth as well as it is to be free from violence.
President Trump, same question to you, and let me remind you of the question. I would like you to speak directly to these families. Do you understand why these parents fear for their children?
Yes, I do. And again, he's been in government 47 years. He never did a thing. Nobody has done more for the black community than Donald Trump. And if you look, with the exception of Abraham Lincoln, possible exception, but the exception of Abraham Lincoln, nobody has done what I've done. Criminal justice reform,
The fact of the matter is, in 2000, though, after the crime bill had been in the law for a while, this is a guy who said the problem with the crime bill, there's not enough people in jail. There's not enough people in jail. And go on my website, get the quote, the date when he said it. Not enough people. This is a guy who in the Central Park five innocent black kids, he continued to push for making sure that they got the death penalty. None of them were guilty. Look, and talk about he did in fact let 20 people, he commuted 20 people's sentences. We commuted over 1,000 people's sentences. Over 1,000. The very law he's talking about is a law that, in fact, initiated by Barack Obama. And secondly, we're in a situation here where the federal prison system was reduced by 38,000 people under our administration. And one of these things we should be doing, there should be no minimum mandatories in the law. That's why I'm offering $20 billion to states to change their state laws to eliminate minimum mandatories and set up drug courts. No one should be going to jail because they have a drug problem. They should be going to rehabilitation, not to jail. We should fundamentally change the system, and that's what I'm going to do.
You know, I ran because of you. I ran because of Barack Obama, because you did a poor job. If I thought you did a good job, I would have never run. I ran because of you. I'm looking at you now. You're a politician. I ran because of you.
All right, Vice President Biden, your response to that, and then I do have some questions for both of you.
Well, I'll tell you what, I hope he does look at me, because what's happening here is, you know who I am, you know who he is, you know his character, you know my character, you know our reputations for honor and telling the truth. I am anxious to have this race. I am anxious to see this take place. The character of the country is on the ballot. Our character is on the ballot. Look at us closely.
Let me ask some follow-up. Please respond, and then we're going to have some.
Then he's a corrupt politician.
Right.
So don't give me the stuff about how you're this innocent baby. Joe, they're calling you a corrupt politician.
Nobody's
calling you. President Trump, I want to stay on the issue. President Trump, we're talking about race right now, and I do want to stay on the issue of race. President Trump,
gentlemen,
I want to stay on the issue of race.
You have to be kidding. Here we go again with Russia.
We're going to continue on the issue of race. Mr. President, you've described the Black Lives Matter movement as a symbol of hate. You've shared a video of a man chanting white power to millions of your supporters. You've said that black professional athletes exercising their First Amendment rights should be fired. What do you say to Americans who say that kind of language from a president is contributing to a climate of hate and racial strife?
Well, you have to understand, the first time I ever heard of Black Lives Matter, they were chanting pigs in a blanket, talking about police. Pigs, talking about our police. Pigs in a blanket, fry them like bacon. I said, that's a horrible thing. And they were marching down the street. And that was my first glimpse of Black Lives Matter. I thought it was a terrible thing. As far as my relationships with all people, I think I have great relationships with all people. I am the least racist person in this room.
Well, what do you say to Americans who are concerned by that rhetoric?
I don't know. I don't know what to say. I got criminal justice reform done and prison reform and opportunity zones. I took care of black colleges and universities. I don't know what to say. They can say anything. I mean, they can say anything. It makes me sad, because I am the least racist person. I can't even see the audience because it's so dark, but I don't care who's in the audience. I'm the least racist person in this room.
Okay, Vice President Biden, Abraham, let me ask you very quickly, and then I have a follow-up question for you.
Abraham Lincoln here is one of the most racist presidents we've had in modern history. He pours fuel on every single racist fire. Every single one. Started off his campaign coming down the escalator saying he's going to get rid of those Mexican rapists. He's banned Muslims because they're Muslims. He has moved around and made everything worse across the board. He says about the poor boys, last time we were on stage here, he said, I told him to stand down and stand ready. Come on. This guy is a dog whistle about as big as a foghorn.
President Trump, I'm going to give you 10 seconds to respond, and then I have a follow-up.
No, he made a reference to Abraham Lincoln. Where did that come in?
I mean, you said you're Abraham Lincoln.
No, where did that? No, no.
You said,
I said, not since Abraham Lincoln has anybody done what I've done for the black community.
And I'm saying,
I didn't say I'm Abraham Lincoln. I said, not since Abraham Lincoln has anybody done what I've done for the black community. community. Now, you have done nothing.
Let me give you a chance to respond within this context. Crime bills that you supported in the 80s and 90s contributed to the incarceration of tens of thousands of young black men who had small amounts of drugs in their possession. They are sons, they are brothers, their fathers, their uncles, whose families are still to this day, some of them suffering the consequences. So speak to those families. Why should they vote for you?
One of the things is that in the 80s, we passed 100%, all 100 senators voted for it, a bill on drugs and how to deal with drugs. It was a mistake. I've been trying to change the sense then, particularly the portion on cocaine. That's why I've been arguing that, in fact, we should not send anyone to jail for a pure drug offense. They should be going into treatment across the board. That's what we should be spending money on. That's why I set up drug courts, which were never funded by our Republican friends. They should not be going to jail for a drug or an alcohol problem. They should be going into treatment. That's what we've been trying to do. That's what I'm going to get done, because I think maybe the American people have now seen that, in fact, it was a mistake to pass those laws relating to drug. But they were not in the crime bill. And by the way, the fastest growing industry in America, solar energy and windmills, is the fastest growing jobs. And they pay good prevailing wages, $45-$50 an hour. We can grow and we can be cleaner if we go the route I'm proposing.
President Trump, please respond,
energy,
and then I have to follow.
We are energy independent for the first time. I know more about wind than you do. It's extremely expensive. Kills all the birds. It's very intermittent. It's got a lot of problems. And they happen to make the windmills in both Germany and China. And the fumes coming up, if you're a believer in carbon emission, the fumes coming up to make these massive windmills is more than anything that we're talking about with natural gas, which is very clean. One other thing.
Find me a scientist
solar.
Said that.
I love solar, but solar doesn't quite have it yet. It's not powerful yet to really run our big, beautiful factories that we need to compete with the world. So
false.
It's all a pipe dream. But you know what we'll do? We're going to have the greatest economy in the world. But if you want to kill the economy, get rid of your oil industry. You want to, and what about fracking?
About what we're talking about. What happened? Parents were ripped, their kids were ripped from their arms and separated. And now they cannot find over 500 of sets of those parents, and those kids are alone. Nowhere to go. Nowhere to go. It's criminal. It's criminal.
Let me ask
Kristen,
you about
I will say this. They went down. We brought reporters, everything. They are so well taken care of. They're in facilities that were so clean.
But some of them haven't been reunited.
But just ask one question. Who built the cages? I'd love you to ask him that. Who built the cages?
Let me ask about your immigration policy, Mr. Vice President. The Obama administration did fail to deliver immigration reform, which had been a key promise during the administration. It also presided over record deportations as well as family detentions at the border before changing course. So why should voters trust you with an immigration overhaul now?
Because we made a mistake. It took too long to get it right. I'll be president of the United States, not vice president of the United States. And the fact is, I've made it very clear. Within 100 days, I'm going to send to the United States Congress a pathway to citizenship for over 11 million undocumented people. And all of those so-called dreamers, those DACA kids, they're going to be immediately certified again to be able to stay in this country and put on a path to citizenship. The idea that they are being sent home by this guy and they want to do that is they've gone to a country they've never seen before. I can imagine you're 5 years old, your parents are taking you across the Rio Grande River and it's illegal. And you say, oh no, mom, leave me here. I'm not going to go with you. They've been here. Many of them are model citizens. Over 20,000 of them are first responders out there taking care of people during this crisis. We owe them.
Kristen, he had 8 years to do what he said he was going to do. And I've changed without having a specific. We got rid of catch and release. We got rid of a lot of horrible things that they put in and that they lived with. But he had 8 years he was vice president. He did nothing except build cages to keep children in.
Vice President
Wrong.
Biden, your response. All right,
now,
leadership, gentlemen. And this first question does go to you, President Trump. Imagine this is your inauguration day. What will you say in your address to Americans who did not vote for you? You'll each have 1 minute, starting with you, Mr.
We President. Have to make a country totally successful as it was prior to the plague coming in from China. Now we're rebuilding it and we're doing record numbers, 11.4 million jobs in a short period of time, etc. But I will tell you, go back. Before the plague came in, just before, I was getting calls from people that were not normally people that would call me. They wanted to get together. We had the best black unemployment numbers in the history of our country. Hispanic, women, Asian, no diplomas, MIT graduates, number one in the class. Everybody had the best numbers. And you know what? The other side wanted to get together. They wanted to unify. Success is going to bring us together. We are on the road to success. But I'm cutting taxes, and he wants to raise everybody's taxes, and he wants to put new regulations on everything. He will kill it. If he gets in, you will have a depression, the likes of which you've never seen. Your 401ks will go to hell, and it'll be a very, very sad day for this country.
All right. Vice President Biden, same question to you. What will you say during your inaugural address to Americans who did not vote for you?
I will say, I'm an American president. I represent all of you, whether you voted for me or against me. And I'm going to make sure that you're represented. I'm going to give you hope. We're going to move. We're going to choose science over fiction. We're going to choose hope over fear. We're going to choose to move forward because we have enormous opportunities to make things better. We can grow this economy. We can deal with the systemic racism. And at the same time, we can make sure that our economy is being run and moved and motivated by clean energy, creating millions of new jobs. And that's the fact. That's what we're going to do. And I'm going to say, as I said at the beginning, what is on the ballot here is the character of this country. Decency, honor, respect, treating people with dignity, making sure that everyone has an even chance. And I'm going to make sure you get that. You haven't been getting it the last 4 years.
And most importantly, thank you to those watching tonight. Election Day is November 3rd. Don't forget to vote. Thank you, everyone, and have a great night.
Thank you.
There you have it, second and final debate of this 2020 election. Donald Trump, Joe Biden, two white men in their 70s, two very different candidates.